30 years after she opened her first shop and took Britain by storm, she's still the biggest name in fashion. In a poll carried out by NOP, 37% of women had heard of Pierre Cardin, 57% knew the name Yves Saint Laurent, but a massive 90% had heard of my guest today, Mary Quant. She shot to fame in those fashion revolutionary days of the mid-50s. For the first time, she created high fashion for the masses. The couturiers followed her. She designed clothes, according to one magazine, that women could run in, move, live and work in. Her designs and clothes expressed a pleasure in being alive, an exuberance and sexual liberation. Now, Mary, I'm not terribly sure what all that means, but let me ask you what fashion means to you. How important and why is it important in your life?
Oh, I feel fashion is about life. It's about everything. It's about the way we sit, the way we move, the way we talk, the style of voice. It's about food, what we eat. It's there. It's about everything.
I don't quite understand that. How can it be about what we eat, for example?
Well, there are fashions now and what we eat. It's fashionable now. We're all eating sort of granary bread and lots more fruit raw food and so on. And I suppose the most fashionable food is Japanese. It's always changing.
We'll talk about the Japanese thing in a moment, because that's obviously very important to you. But let's stick with fashion in terms of design and particularly clothes design. Mm-hmm. I mean, that, does it not, follows our social habits and social trends. In what way does it manage to do that?
I think fashion anticipates. It seems to get there first, and then it unravels behind it. Fashion's always changing. It's always about the next thing. It's there, and then I think the one takes from it what one wants to use for oneself, and you leave the rest there. So you take from it. It's always happening. It's always changing. You take from it and make it yours.
But that's an extraordinary comment you've just made. I mean, are you actually suggesting that by looking at today's fashions, whatever they are, and honestly they perplex me, I'm not quite sure what today's fashion is, but you can tell me what it is that a guide to the way we are going to live and behave next year or in the next decade? You say it actually leads our behaviour?
Yes, I think so.
It's amazing.
I think it's very clear looking back. I mean, in the fashions of the early 60s were tremendously exuberant and extrovert and independent. And they're very clear to see looking back. And they expressed all the emancipation that was about to happen then.
Yes, you see, I would have thought that was reflecting. I mean, I'm old enough, you're not, to go back to the end of the war and the new look, you know, the long flowing skirts that came in and all the rest of it. Were they not reflecting, yes, the war's over and suddenly clothes rationing's over and suddenly we can use a lot of material? Well, wasn't that reflecting rather than projecting?
Yes, well, first you got the new look, as you say, and that was a kind of reaction of a retro everything, back to romance, back to corsets and skirts and so on, which was just a sort of flash. And then one started to get this independent, outgoing, very young, very alive look that came in the 60s.
You talk about the 60s.
And very anticipated the 60s. Yeah. And same thing happened before the 70s. One got the uniform of denim. One got this heavyweight political despondency. And then, sure enough, it had all arrived. And going into the 80s, we got a renewal of this liveliness and originality and outgoingness and healthiness in the clothes, not just the food, you know, tracksuits. And the whole thing started to express the mood that was going to come.
Still perhaps not quite as swinging as the swinging 60s, which you keep referring to,
yes,
and a lot of people think of you in those terms.
Yes.
In actual fact, it was the 50s, was it not, when you really began? You set up your bazaar.
It was the 50s, anticipating the 60s.
Ah,
getting stronger,
clever
stronger.
Again.
Yes.
Tell me how
that
all happened.
Is.
I mean, you know, if I read biographies of people such as yourself, to me there always seems to be a missing chapter. You know, he opened his first factory. In your case, you opened your first shop. Mm. Never quite sure how that happened, though. Where did the money come from? How did it all begin?
Well, I just always wanted to do this. I didn't like clothes the way they were. I didn't like the clothes that I inherited from a cousin. They weren't me. I was always, from a very, very young age, from about 5, 6, 7, trying to make my own clothes, which were, well, very strongly the look that I still love. In fact, it was summed up by a girl at dancing class who had a sort of, what really is a bucket or a V-Dow haircut. and wore a long skinny black sweater and about 6 inches of black pleated skirt, black tights, white ankle socks. It's a great coup, and black patent leather shoes with a button on top. The skirt was minutely short. She was very complete head to toe. She was it, and the look that has always been in my head. But I went to art school, and I met Alexander, my husband, and I also met Archie McNair, our third partner. Alexander inherited 5,000 when he was 21. Archie put up another 5,000, and we started on that. I mean, nobody told us that, apart from the premises, one needed working capital. Nobody told us we couldn't do it, and we did it.
Did you get a bit of a shock when you came upon the realities, harsh realities of business and commerce and all that?
Hell of a shock.
As you say, but it was very little, really.
Yes, we didn't know about markup, we didn't know about working capital, and so the clothes were underpriced, which probably helped enormously. But the thing was, we opened the door of the shop, and there was a queue, and people were four deep outside, and people just flooded in. We were almost overwhelmed by the success of the thing. And the clothes were very simple, very bold. I persuaded knitwear manufacturers to make men's cardigans, like Rex Harrison cardigans, about 10 inches longer, which was a very short dress length. I persuaded theatrical manufacturers to make tights in all the colours of the clothes, and black, of course. And I bought men's suitings from Harrods, pinstripe trouser stuff, you know, and shirtings and things, and had elongated shirts made, I called dresses, and bathing suits from theatrical leotards, and tunic dresses from these pinstripe men's suitings of Prince of Wales and, you know, Czechs and things like that, with skinny ribby sweaters underneath and skinny ribby tights to match. We were nearly overwhelmed. I had to somehow see that the stuff sold in order to get the money to run back to Harrods to buy some more stuff. So it was an absolutely basic fundamental in business to learn that one had to move the things around.
One of the fundamentals of business, even in high fashion, is branding, really, isn't it? Is the name. Mm-hmm. And that's a magic name, Mary Quant, or do I say that with hindsight? It's an unusual name. Is it your real name?
It is my name. That is my name.
That's the family name.
It's an extraordinary name, isn't it? And it's got good letters.
Yes,
the
sure.
M and the Q.
So that was a bit strong. Of luck. So there's Alexander, the husband, with some money. It was a bit of luck. The name was a bit of luck. The flair, of course, there's nothing lucky about that.
I think it was enormous good luck to have a partner that was in Archie McNair, who was a lawyer, and I don't believe he'd ever survived. And Alexander, who was just the greatest salesman ever and was an entrepreneur. The look I was obsessed with and always will be. And that being fashion, changed and unrolled in front of us.
Did you have a supportive family? I've talked about Quant being the family name. Were they supportive?
They were. My parents were school teachers. They were very against my going to fashion. They thought it very, very dicey. They were very keen, very certain that people had to, particularly girls, had to make their own careers. They were against fashion. It was too risky. So the compromise was a straight art school, which at that time for me turned out to be a great advantage. It was the fashion schools then, I'm afraid, taught people to go to Paris, look at couture collections, and then sort of regurgitate them down to mass-produced clothes. So it was a bit like, you know, getting hold of a Rolls-Royce design and then squeezing it into a very small scale and very cheap stuff and turning it out and calling it a mini. It was absolutely the wrong, people were designing the wrong way around. Whereas, what I knew I wanted to do was design the mini from the beginning, straight at it.
But did you?
That's the way I worked.
Is the mini truly yours?
Oh yes, because the Chelsea girl, you know, she had the best legs in the world. She wanted the short skirts that I was making there, the elongated cardigan.
So it's
and she wore it. She had the courage to wear it. My God.
It's scandalously untrue what I've read, that Courage, or one of those people, first actually introduced the mini. You spotted its tremendous potential and went from there.
Is what I was doing. But Courage was enormous help because he made it respectable.
Yes. And your revolution, apart from your design and your eye and your flair and all these things we've talked about, the revolution was, as we said earlier, bringing all this to the typist in the city office who could suddenly afford high fashion.
Yes, because I believe that fashion is for real-life people and not for a small minority.
Now, in the 60s, in the mid-60s, you went from fashion in terms of clothes into cosmetics very heavily, and you still are. Is cosmetics similarly some part of our social history, and how?
I see fashion as a head-to-toe thing. It's how you put the whole thing together and then the way it moves. And Vidal was cutting the hair in absolute the way. We became great friends because we were so in sympathy. And he cut the hair as though it was real. He cut it to make a frame around the face. And he roughed it up and he cut it on the cross and he did every sort of exciting thing with the hair. I'd persuaded the tights manufacturers, producing the clothes I wanted and so on. Everything was there from head to toe except the face. And makeup was all wrong. Makeup was made by very big cosmetic companies who got stuck. And the whole attitude was quite wrong. It was very hard and lacquered and quite wrong. I became more and more interested in makeup and watched some of the absolutely top photographic models who were the only girls I used to use to model, people like Shrimpton and Twiggy and really the absolute top people. And they used makeup in a completely different way. They used their face as a canvas. And then they painted on top, rather like an impressionist painter, with brushes, you know, often a foot long, and with great pots of colours and boxes of theatrical coloured powders and things, often using the things in the absolutely the opposite part of the face they were intended. And this liveness and this exciting approach was so intriguing. I wanted to rationalise that into the sort of size thing you could put in a handbag and carry around with you. And also to rationalise the packaging, so that it was something more like a very smart lighter that you actually wanted to flourish and pull out of your bag. You know. In fact, I started with crayons out of a crayon tin and started like that.
How do you rationalise makeup itself? Why do you make up? Is it to attract men? Is there something sexual in it? Is it to be admired by other women? Is it to hide behind? Because I suspect
all those things.
We may talk of this, that I think you're rather shy person, aren't you? But what is makeup about?
Yes, first? I think it's all those things. I think it's a way of painting one's face. It's a little way of making love to oneself to get ready for whatever one's going to do, whether it be work in the morning or a party, in which case one would use more wild colour, and getting oneself into the mood for the part you want to play. And giving yourself courage, as you say. And very often you can then sweep into the role you want to play as a result of the whole build-up.
Helps a bit on television in the studio.
It helps a bit on television, as you all know.
You talked of hairstyle and Vidal Sassoon and all
yes.
that. Again, is this the shyness? But you seem to tend to almost hide behind that fringe
preferably,
there.
Preferably, yes.
Almost cutting out the eyes and that sort of thing. Really, do you find a need to do that? You are, being such a public person, nevertheless a very shy person.
I am.
So how do you cope?
I don't.
You do? You're sitting here talking to me in front of millions. But you must find a way. Is it to do with hiding the eyes and the makeup and perhaps the dress and other things that help you to cope with that shyness?
Yes, absolutely. I remember being American being asked, you know, what is this shy thing? Is this the new fashion? I exploded with anger, so I stopped being shy.
I read a story somewhere about how actually when you were being pursued or likely to be pursued by the press in some airport or other, you actually hid in the lavatory because you couldn't face people after getting off an airplane. Is that kind of thing true of you?
Yes, that did happen.
Right.
Very embarrassing.
Let us go back to the fashion thing because there's so much more that's intriguing about it. One of the things that always astonishes me, and I've sought the answer and never got it, maybe you've got it for me, is how does it happen that we wake up one morning and suddenly all the shops have got, I don't know, floral trousers or whatever, and suddenly we know that the colour for autumn is blueberry or whatever it may be. I mean, it does, doesn't it? Is there some kind of mafia? I can't believe that it's just some extraordinary instinct that you all have and it all works the same way at the same time.
Well, I think you're right, it's in the air. It's a sort of magic.
Really?
And I think fashion is about change. So it's about not being bored and not allowing the things that surround one to become hackneyed. It's about the next thing. So just as when colours become so boring that one stops to noticing, you know, there is a need and a reaching for the next thing. And as people who are fashion designers are obsessed with change and always reaching for the next thing, they get bored more quickly, I think, than anyone else.
Yeah, so but that doesn't answer, that doesn't explain why, let's say, being bored with dark colours, suddenly for spring everything's yellow. I mean, it might be bright green or it might be or whatever, but everything is yellow one year. How does that happen all at the same time?
Yes, because the designers are working way ahead. They are bored more quickly than anybody else. They're bored with black, and so they're reaching for the opposite.
Almost. But why do they all reach for the same colour? And indeed the same fabrics. Linen is in or whatever.
They reach for the colour that hasn't been there.
Yes.
Or the combination of colours that haven't been there. The juxtaposition of colours that haven't been used. So there's a feeding for the very colours that one hated.
But there is no real sort of mafia. There's no behind-the-scenes gathering of people, leaders of fashion like yourself.
No, Michael, because I think everybody tries to be rather secretive about this. But they're all reaching ahead, and the appetite, the feel for, is a logical one, and it is a progression. And then there are all the yarn people, the fabric people, the trade fairs, all anticipating the fabrics. And everybody goes there, everybody tries to be secret, and yet the eye just hones in on the juxtaposition of colours, the combinations that seem most attractive and that one hasn't seen before. It's a feeling for newness. And then there's a battle, there's a race to try to get there first, because that's what fashion designers love doing. And so these start to happen often more quickly than is anticipated, and they shoot into the shops. And so then the appetite, they're eaten more quickly than anyone appreciated. And so then there's an undertow of another group of colours that were also fighting to surface, which become even more attractive within that season. And so the whole ball goes round again, with lots and lots of fashion forecasting agencies and firms that everybody uses. But they're all on the same pattern, the same reaching for something new.
Am I right in thinking, I'm possibly showing my ignorance now, but thinking that Japan is now the in thing in fashion? From the way you dress almost now, it looks like it.
I think Japan has had more effect on fashion than anywhere else over the last 5 years. And as their fashion industry is only about 12 years old, it is an amazing thing. First they came to Europe and copied, as we always say about the Japanese. And one saw more and more of them arriving in Como and in Paris, where the fabrics are being sold. And then they acquired the skills, they acquired all that know-how and the feeling for what is coming next, what is needed. But they then started creating, and I think completely revolutionized fashion, because they had their approach, which is a different way of feeling about clothes altogether. It really is a wrapping and a tying. And using the body almost as a sort of present, wrapping it up with bows as a parcel. And the lovely Japanese idea somehow, which is all there with the kimono and the bow on the back, that the magic moment you pull one string of the bow and the whole delicious package unravels in front of your eyes.
That's a lovely thought.
Which is delicious, I think.
To a man, anyway, it is.
So
you seem to be yourself, in a sense, hooked on Japan now. You do a lot of business there. The influence is there, and what you wear, all that sort of thing. In a sense, that seems odd, because it is such a male-dominated society, or was. Maybe things are changing faster than we realise, are they?
Well, things are changing enormously fast. I mean, now Europe does look Japan for influence, and so does America. They are originating, and this is happening in every field. So it is the most fascinating place. Their stores are absolutely extraordinary, are leading the world in many, many ways. I think in every era they are so inventive and are creating. So it's absolutely delicious for me that they are buying more of our things and more of our designs than anywhere else in the world. It is an absolutely vast market for us, and I love it. And I work over there with a team of Japanese, little Japanese girls, obviously delicious. And we have, over 2 years, got 72 shops going in the stores there and one freestanding shop the middle of Tokyo. It's and I take the designs over there and work with them, and the cosmetics are there in the centre. People are encouraged to come and have tea, to experiment with the makeup, and then to buy the tracksuits, the leotards, the tops and the bottoms and the accessories.
So there are a whole lot of very good reasons for your liking Japan.
I love it.
I mean, do you like, you love it, you say. Do you love it then enough to, would you ever think of going to live there?
Oh, no. I'll always live in England. I that's my place. I love it here. But to work, I enjoy Tokyo enormously, as I do New York. But to live, England.
It's got to be here. So what is it about England then that you love?
It's the shape of the countryside. It's the rain.
The rain?
Mm.
Why do you love the rain?
I like the colour. I like the hedges.
Is
I like the weeds.
Weeds? Is there also a pride in being British? I mean, this is, in
very
a sense,
much.
Taking you back to
very
the
much,
commercial
yes.
side of
yes.
your life and your business and all that sort of thing, and buying British and so forth. You do have a pride in that?
Enormously. I like, it's rather like Japan in that we, in many ways, are so original and individual. And we live, I think, now very dashing daytime life, and we still revert to a rather Victorian private life at weekends and evenings. And I love the stylishness of the English.
Tell me about your private life just a little. Not so private that you wouldn't want to make it public here, but I mean, how important is your marriage to you and your son, Orlando?
Priority.
But absolute priority.
But my whole life works together. I mean, I just blur the whole thing. So work, and because Alexander and I work together, the whole thing moves along together. My garden, the whole thing moves together.
Does that bring particular difficulties and pressures working together and having done so for so many years and often through fairly traumatic situations, at least at the beginning in a commercial sense? Is it difficult for the two of you to be in each other's pockets all day long, I suppose?
Well, it makes your rows much more interesting. I mean, they're not just about the housekeeping or the wet towels. There's a very wide span of terrifically exciting rows one can have. But how badly I did this interview.
The
advertising we're going to see this afternoon, the designs that aren't finished for Japan when I leave on Saturday. I mean, there's a wealth of possibilities for Rao with Alexander tonight, which are most exciting.
And Orlando, your son?
Orlando is, I think, most amused and very interested and very stylish.
An amusing name, Orlando.
It's a good name. The O's are very pleasing, aren't they? Ah. And the whole sound and roll of it, delicious.
Let me ask you just very briefly about what fame and riches have meant to you. For a start, you're very rich, aren't you?
I don't think I am. No.
You look as if that through you, but surely you've lived with being rich for 3 decades now.
I have a very healthy respect and lack of respect for money. For me, it means being able to move to places fast in the way you want to. It's a sort of freedom, isn't it? I must say, I enjoy it.
Don't ask me. And fame, and your OBE. What did the honour of the OBE mean to you?
It was very pleasing. Very pleasing. Very
more than that.
Proud.
Proud, yes.
Yes.
And how are you coping with fame? We talked earlier about shyness. Seeing your name on posters still wherever you move.
I love it.
Every magazine you pick up.
I love it.
The Mary Quant name everywhere. You really can cope
enjoy
with
it.
That. What would you say to your son Orlando then about fame and fortune and the future for him? Would you like him to go in the sort of business you've been in?
I'd like him to find the thing that he will enjoy as much as I enjoy working. I think he will. And I think it'll be more fun for him if it's entirely his thing.
What would you then say to others of perhaps his age who are talented and who seek the kind of fame in your kind of world nowadays, who are very young and who perhaps haven't got a slightly wealthy husband? How can they get on?
I think it's about what you want to do or what you want to say or what you want to paint, or it's what you want to do.
You're a great believer, obviously.
Not about I want to be famous.
The possible. Everything is possible to you.
Everything is possible, isn't it?
It has been for you. Mary Quant, it's been a delight to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Michael, thank you.